Greetings, fellow humans. It sure is great to be a human, isn't it? A good old Homo sapien, a big homo. But did you know that throughout history there have been many homos? Of course, we're all homos.
You're the homos! Every last one of you!
But as of right now, we are the only homos. Homo sapiens are the only existing humans on the planet, emerging some 300,000 years ago. But there were other species and subspecies of human before us, and some even existed at the same time as us. For example, the Neanderthal, which is sometimes used as a synonym for a primitive Homo sapien, but was in fact its own species. Now, as I said, all of these other species of humans are all extinct now, although some of them live on through some of us in traces of DNA, meaning we mated with some of them. It's debated exactly how many human species existed due to limited physical evidence in some cases. It's possible there are species we haven't discovered yet, and also there's a lot of debate over whether some of these humans counted as their own distinct species or merely a subspecies. That's certainly not my area of expertise. Actually, nothing really is, so I'll just present that information as I've read it. And without further ado, let's take a look at the OG homos. Homo habilis. Homo habilis, or handyman, existed 2.3 to 1.6 million years ago in East and South Africa. The remains were first discovered in the 1960s. Not much is known about these guys, and a lot of that is contested. It seems they were small, ape-like little dudes, being 3 or 4 feet tall, being covered in thick body hair. They are credited with manufacturing the Oldowan stone tool industry, that is, tools that are made by using a stone to chip sharp edges into another stone. These sharpened stones would have been used to butcher meat. They didn't require a lot of foresight or planning to make, and probably would have been discarded immediately after use. Homo habilis would have lived at least partially in the trees, and their society was much like that of modern chimps and baboons. So really, it seems that they were more or less apes with a primitive usage of tools. We're not really sure what happened to them, and there's no consensus whether or not they evolved into later humans or they were a separate branch completely. The remains of a left foot belonging to a member of Homo habilis appear to have been bitten off by a huge extinct crocodile. I just thought that was interesting. Homo rudolfensis. These dudes existed in East Africa about 2 million years ago and would have coexisted with Homo habilis. Seems they were similar to Homo habilis, except they were bigger, possibly being up to a foot taller. They're not associated with tool use, and their classification as Homo has been debated since their discovery in 1972. So not too interesting, and once again, there's no consensus on how they relate to later humans. Homo erectus. Homo erectus. Alright, we can end the video there. It's not gonna get much better than this. Homo erectus, or upright man, existed 2 million years ago and is thought to be the first Homo to travel out of Africa and spread out across the Old World. The emergence of Homo erectus signaled to the rest of the animal kingdom that us Homos were kicking things into second gear. The first remains, the Java man, were discovered in 1893 in Indonesia by researchers looking for the missing link between apes and humans. It's speculated that Homo erectus evolved from Homo habilis. Homo erectus survived for almost 2 million years, and there have been a lot of similar human remains that scientists aren't sure are separate species or are subspecies of Homo erectus, but more on that later. Homo erectus was bipedal and about the same size and proportion as us, possibly a little smaller. They had a flat face and are believed to be the first human species with a projecting nose. Humans had probably started losing most of their body hair by this stage and instead developed dark skin to protect them from the sun. The group hunted animals as large as elephants and graduated from Aldewan technology to Ahulian tools. Ahulian tools being similar, but instead of just chipping a sharp edge on a rock, more thought and consideration is put into the overall shape of the tool. They would chip the rock on both faces until it was symmetrical, leaving them with a multi-purpose hand axe, the longest used tool in human history. Homo erectus is also credited with early humans' first use of fire. Artificial lighting would have provided them with more waking hours and may have encouraged increased socializing time, which possibly was the origin of early language. Sites of rock piles dating back a million years are claimed as evidence for early architecture. It's speculated these circles of rocks were used to hold up branches or poles, which were the basis of some form of shelter. Nobody knows exactly when clothing was invented, but their tools would have allowed them to skin animal hides, which they could have used in place of their lost body hair. Ahulian artifacts found on isolated islands indicate Homo erectus may even have had seafaring capability. Some remains display signs that the individual lived with an impairment, such as toothlessness or scoliosis, suggesting that there was some level of care provided by the rest of the group. That's more advanced healthcare than some countries today. There is some possible evidence to suggest Homo erectus appreciated art, engraving artifacts and collecting ochre for paint. That would suggest that they had an understanding of symbolic and abstract thinking, although the evidence here really isn't strong enough to say for definite that Homo erectus did these things intentionally. In fact, because Homo erectus lived for so long and spread out across the world, it's hard to say if many of these things can be attributed to Homo erectus as a whole, or if they were just isolated incidents by certain groups in certain places at certain times. Regardless, this is definitely a step up for humans. Every other animal on the planet is basically fucked at this point. While they were putting all their evolution points into being big and strong, we were learning how to come together as a group and throw rocks. Oops, looks like you're gonna have to spend the next several million years subservient to us, you stupid fucking animals. I mean, it's seen some advances, but really getting together and throwing rocks is still the strategy for humans. The English had their longbowmen, guns were so good we decided that one world war just wasn't enough for us, and now we have nukes. So, thank you, Homo erectus. The last known occurrence of Homo erectus is around 100,000 years ago in Indonesia, so there was still some around by the time Homo sapiens came onto the scene. Did we ever cross paths? Maybe. Maybe that contributed to their disappearance. Homo ergaster. Homo ergaster, or working man, lived in Africa around the same time Homo erectus did, although they seemingly died out several hundreds of thousands of years before erectus did. Being very similar to erectus, it's believed ergaster may have been a sort of precursor to later Homo erectus, although it's unclear if ergaster is its own species or a subspecies. Homo erectus gets all the glory for all the great things they did, but if ergaster really is its own distinct species, then they actually did it all beforehand. With increasing populations, groups splintered and ventured off to find new resources, eventually leading them into Europe and Asia. They would have done all the same things I said Homo erectus is credited for. If these really are the ancestors to modern humans, their origin is still a bit unclear. It's theorized they came from Homo habilis, but there's a bit of a leap between the smaller, more ape-like habilis and these lanky boys, so maybe we're just missing something in the middle there. So the question then is, was Homo ergaster the true rock-throwing hero of the human race, or were they just early Homo erectus and the perceived differences just down to the fact that Homo erectus was a diverse species that lived for a very long time and likely looked a little different throughout their 2 million years on Earth? Homo heidelbergensis. It's thought Homo heidelbergensis descended from the humans who first expanded out of Africa, either Homo erectus or Homo ergaster. Similarly to ergaster, some think that heidelbergensis may be a subspecies of Homo erectus, in this case, of course, late erectus rather than early. They may be the last common ancestor of modern humans and Neanderthals. They were a little stockier than us, a trait that Neanderthals would inherit, while we would grow taller and thinner, making us a unique build among humans. There is evidence that some stone tools were hafted onto sticks to create spears around 300,000 years ago, so Homo heidelbergensis may have been the first to use more advanced tools and weaponry. Developments in their anatomy support the view that they were possibly using a form of early language. Homo rhodesiensis. Some think this species may have arisen from the humans who stayed in Africa when Homo heidelbergensis was emerging in Europe, although the evidence for this is not definitive, so moving on. Homo antecessor. Believed to possibly be an early form of Homo heidelbergensis, but it's debated. Homo naledi. Homo naledi is believed to have been a species of human that existed around 300,000 years ago. 15 of the fuckers were found in a cave in South Africa in 2013. It's not clear how they relate to the rest of the human line, though they seem to be more primitive than Homo erectus. They were a little smaller and their limbs more adapted to climbing trees. The fossils were not associated with any tools, but they would have had the capability to make Oldowan tools at least. The bodies were all found in a chamber that is relatively hard to get to and showed no evidence of trauma, leading some to believe they were intentionally buried in some sort of funeral, so perhaps they had some sort of concept of an afterlife. Homo neanderthalensis. The great Neanderthal lived in Eurasia until its extinction around 40,000 years ago. It's thought they descended from Homo heidelbergensis, but it's unclear when exactly this occurred. They were shorter and more robust than us and lived in cold, high-stress environments competing with other apex predators. The decreased sunlight would have led them to having somewhat lighter skin than other Homo species, but this would have varied from region to region. Their population numbers were always quite low, estimated at having an effective population of around 3 to 12,000, and they were distributed sparsely across regions. It's thought they lived in hunter-gatherer groups consisting of 10 to 30 people. Because there were so few of them spread out across such a large area, it's thought a group or tribe would have interacted with the neighboring communities, but not much further beyond that. They probably had language and some understanding of trade, as indicated by artifacts that were found hundreds of miles away from where the materials existed to make them. There's also evidence of them perpetrating violence against each other, with several skeletons showing traumas characteristic of man-made weapons, so maybe they maintained allegiances with some groups for mating and trading, and feuded with others. There's even some butchery marks on some skeletons, meaning they were probably cannibalized, although this is relatively rare and it's unknown if this was done ritualistically or out of desperate hunger amid food shortages. It's thought they would have mostly lived in caves and thus would have had to contend with cave bears and cave hyenas. This is going back to their high stress environment. The vast majority of them died before 40. Many remains sport healed severe traumas, meaning the Neanderthals had some understanding of medicine. Wounds were probably bandaged and broken bones were reset with splints. There's even one example of an amputation of the right arm following a broken bone. They appreciated art on some level, using ochre as paint and collecting and modifying objects to adorn their clothes. They engraved objects with scratches, perhaps as some form of symbolic art. They may have made bone flutes to play music, but that's highly debated. They existed at the same time as Homo sapiens, and we even met each other as Homo sapiens migrated into their territories. I wonder, did they recognize they were different species, or did they just think they were from some faraway tribe? Regardless, DNA evidence strongly indicates interbreeding between Neanderthals and early Homo sapiens. It's estimated that 20% of Neanderthal DNA survives in modern humans. Eventually, however, Homo sapiens replaced Neanderthals and they disappeared. What caused them to go extinct? We're not exactly sure, but we might have had something to do with it. Homo sapiens could have preyed on and exterminated the seemingly more peaceful and less advanced Neanderthals, or we could have simply outperformed them in the highly competitive environment, or we could have introduced them to diseases that they had no immunity to. Whatever the case, the fact that they had a much smaller population than us likely played a part. Quite sad when you think about it, a whole separate species of human that coexisted with us just eradicated. Imagine the world today if there were two species of human. Realistically, we probably would have treated them like shit for all of history. If they'd survived until modern times, they'd probably have their own civil rights movement. Sad, but interesting to think about. Would they have had their own empires? Would they have been colonized? Would they have fought in the world wars? Would they have been targets of the Holocaust? Would they have been revolutionaries or counterculturalists? There's an alternative history graphic novel in there for sure. Homo Erotica. Sorry, Freudian slip there. Homo Denisova, or the Denisovans, existed in Asia around the same time as us and the Neanderthals. There's not much physical remains of them known to us, so most of what we know about them comes from DNA evidence. They were genetically much closer to Neanderthals than they were to Homo sapiens. They met and interbred with both of us. They get their name from Denisova Cave, where the majority of their remains were discovered, including these tools and ornaments, and a 90,000-year-old girl called Deni, whose father was a Denisovan and whose mother was a Neanderthal. Homo floresiensis. Homo floresiensis, or hobbits, are curious little fellows who lived on the island of Flores in Indonesia, emerging a little later than 2 million years ago and surviving as recent as 50,000 years ago. Discovered in 2003, they were small little dudes, only about 3 feet, which is where they get their nickname of hobbits, after the short-statured race of creatures in J.R.R. Tolkien's fantasy universe. I swear I'm not making this up. They, or their evolutionary ancestors, could only have made it to the island by seafaring, possibly on little bamboo rafts. There's evidence they used fire to cook meat, and a load of little stone tools they used were found too. Some of these tools were associated with the remains of the extinct elephant Stegodon, so they probably hunted them. They disappeared roughly around the same time Homo sapiens came into the area, so we probably had something to do with it. In 2012, a New Zealand scientist was forbidden by the Tolkien estate to use the term hobbit to promote his upcoming lecture on the species. And there you have it, the great homos of yore. Actually, there's some I didn't mention, but you can probably guess why. Their classification is debated and there's little known about them, so I just didn't bother. There's no point talking about 7 different dudes when they're all possibly Homo erectus anyway. Well, a scientist might disagree with that, but I'm just making YouTube videos, so fuck that. Very interesting to think about what humans were like a million years ago. Of course, we didn't exist back then, and I wonder, will we exist in the coming million years? It'll presumably be much easier for Homo sapiens a million years from now to study us, assuming our wealth of recorded history survives. Maybe they'll even be able to look back at photos and videos of us and think, wow, they looked so different back then. Handsome. Imagine them trying to figure out what the fuck they're looking at as they watch Darth Vader fight Luke Skywalker, or Hulk Hogan join the NWO, or Robb Stark march on the Riverlands. They'd be like, what the fuck is this? Do these depict real historical events? Did this really happen, or is this just a recreation of what they think happened? And maybe Homo sapiens won't survive another million years. Maybe something will happen to us. Maybe another species will take our place, or maybe the Earth will just be without humans for a long, long time. Then, through evolution, some form of humans could slowly emerge again, and the Earth is now just covered in these old technological artifacts from civilizations that disappeared millions of years ago, and they have to figure out what the fuck all this stuff is and where it all came from. Imagine living on a world where there's overwhelming evidence that some technologically advanced creature lived there millions of years before you, and you've just no idea where they came from or where they went. Maybe we're the ones that actually have come after, and there was a species like us millions of years before us, and they just cleaned up all the evidence and fucked off. Maybe they check in on us every now and then. Yeah, probably not. But it's fun to think about. Anyways, bye.